Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. We're back. It's Wednesday. Thump it. It's the thump day. Maybe the hump day, but certainly this is where you really hit it and you make the week work for you. That's the day to do just that. I hope you found yesterday's presentation. You should listen to it and share it with your leadership team. That's really vital. How to take and give criticism. How to take and give criticism. And you've got to be really good at taking it, and you also have to be pretty good at giving it. And I gave you some tips on how you can do just that. So I hope you'll listen to that again and perhaps share it with others. Hey, today I have a wonderful statement which caught my attention. It came from the Epic Times, and it simply said, "Character and fate are the same thing." Character equals fate. It is your character which will determine your fate. And then it was given by a guy named Novalis, N-O-V-A-L-I-S. And I'd never heard of Novalis. So I looked it up and found out it was the pen name of a gentleman, here we go, George Philipp Friedrich Freiherr von Hardenberg. That's right. George Philipp Friedrich Freiherr von Hardenberg. And that was his pen name. And he was an incredible writer, a genius, and he only lived to be 28 years of age, but in that time did an incredible amount of work and was everything from a great philosopher to a man who could manage a salt mine. Novalis. So you might find him interesting, but I particularly like the idea because we're going to talk about image today. That instead of taking that long, complicated name, for as part of his image, he just went by Novalis. You know, and people do that today. We think of Brando, you know, and then there was Cher, Madonna, Oprah. So it might be fun to simply say, what would be your stage name or your perhaps your pen name if you write, your performance name? And what would be your one-word name? Sometimes I just simply say, you know, Stan. That's who I am. Just call me Stan. That'll do. So think about that. Now, the reason I'm doing that is today I have, I believe, one of those good lessons. It's about 10, 11 minutes. And it's based on the idea, image is not everything, but it is the first thing. And so you're going to have to learn how to manage your image. So, here we go. What do you think? I like these. I have a lot of these bright ties. Should I have worn a tie for this presentation? Or do you think maybe I should have just taken my jacket off and just kind of been in shirt sleeves? What about my glasses? Is it a good thing that I wear the glasses? Is that good, or is it okay that I wear glasses? And of course, one of the most distinctive things about me is I completely shave my head. Now, what does all of that mean? Well, that's in some way how every day I get up and make a decision about how to present myself to you and to the many people that I meet. We're talking about our image. And what we have to understand is very simply that image is not everything. And years ago, that was a statement made by a world-class tennis player who decided that he would actually enhance his marketability by the way he wore his hair and the way he dressed. And as he even said, not the outfit, the costume that I wear. And when challenged about it, because
The game of tennis at the professional level was not just about winning at tennis. It was about endorsements and it was about products. And you know how that works. Simply said, you got to remember, image is everything. Well, image is not everything. I believe character is more important than cute. I believe substance is more important than mere style. I believe that the quality of one's character is vital to who they are. So image is not everything, not by a long shot. But image is important. And whether we like it or not, image is the first thing. We've all heard the line about you can't get a first impression over again. Rightly or wrongly, we judge people by how they first appear. Now, years ago, there was quite a dress code in the world. And when you look back at the pictures of the 1950s, maybe 60s, around the 60s and 70s, obviously, with what was called the revolution, the style of dress began to change. And, of course, through the 60s and 70s, there were a variety of styles that were almost revolutionary. They were certainly upsetting to the status quo. And so what became a cultural manifestation, how we dress and how we appear, not only took on image implications, but it took on political implications, class implications, racial and ethnic configurations. All of that went in. And now today, whether we're talking about whether you have a tattoo, whether you wear an earring, whether you shave your head, all of those go in to the image that we have. Now, what I simply want to say to you is, you need to manage your image. Be aware of it. Be conscious of it. Now, someone said, why should I do that? Well, first of all, keep in mind that you already have an image. Used car salesman, accountant, doctor, librarian, insurance agent, professional wrestler. What came to mind? And I could keep going. Image came to your mind, a little bit of a picture that was oftentimes based on your past experience. I was working in the insurance industry for a number of years, and one gentleman said to me that when he sat down on an airplane and he was tired out and didn't particularly want to talk to his seatmate, he just wanted to take it easy, if they would say, what do you do? He would say, oh, I sell life insurance. And he said, usually that kind of put an end to the conversation if I wanted to put an end to it. Because obviously people have some image of insurance agents. Now, whatever you are and whatever you do, we all carry an image that the person gives you. They give you that image based on their experience. And so unless you want to accept the image they give you, you're going to have to manage it yourself. And that's what I'm asking you to think about. How do you manage your image? How do you want other people to view you? Now, I can say this. There are ways that I want to view myself. There's ways that I want to appear. There are ways that I want to look. Now, my wife and I go through this every once in a while. Let's face it, I'm a bit old school, and I like to dress quite formally. You know, I'm very happy in a white shirt, French cuffs, and my Donald Trump type tie. I like that. And I like my wingtip shoes and I like my dress clothes. And I'm very uncomfortable in a lot of the, quote, casual wear that passes these days. I just don't do it well. It doesn't feel right by me. I'm just not comfortable that way. But my wife will say, you know, you look a little stuffy to people. You might look a little eccentric to people. You might come off as a really old-fashioned. So I have to consider two things. How do I want to appear? How do I feel at my best? On the other hand, I have to understand that there are scads of people out there. And as my good friend, who's a professional clothes tailor and dresser, says, your clothes talk. What are they saying? Do you like what they're saying? Your clothes talk. Your image talks. Just to give you an example, how accidentally or not, a couple years ago, I was doing a workshop in the country of Brazil. Well, it turns out when I came in, there was all kinds of comments because one of the favorite TV shows in Brazil are reruns of an old American television series called Kojak, in which a tough, hard cop is the main character, and he has, even before the times, a shaved head. And then, literally, the shaved head was made popular by Michael Jordan, one of the classic basketball players in the National Basketball Association of the United States. So all of these things go into what we are. At the same time, I've had people say to me, I've never lost a sale because I dressed up. The other people would say is, I made lots of sales because I didn't look like a stuffed shirt salesperson. Is there any answer? Well, let me just suggest a few things. First of all, dressing up is usually never out of style, and perhaps it's good to sometimes be slightly above the audience that you're working or the people you're with. Way above? Be careful. But dressing up, appearing nice, usually never goes quite out of style. Secondly, your image is oftentimes enhanced by simply how you treat people. We talked about being very present to people. That's part of your image. I have a gentleman who says, I enhance my image by the practice of, with my colleagues particularly and with my clients, I love to give simple gifts. Nothing expensive, simple gifts. Another says, I write handwritten thank you notes on fine stationery. That's part of my image. I always stand when someone comes to the table. I greet people by their name. There are 101 ways in which it doesn't cost a cent. Your image is not just what you wear. It is how you connect with other people. And we've talked about the secret sign being part of your image. The other thing that's vital to understand is that when it comes to your image, that you have to go through a process of discovering what might be best for you. Now, I don't know if you've ever heard of color analysis, but based on our skin tone, based on a number of things, there are certain colors and certain things that look better on us. There are certain clothes and certain ways that we can wear them based on our shape and our figure that work with us. There is another situation where, in effect, based on your personality, you can do and say and be things that create an image which is totally acceptable as people know and understand you, but would certainly be a little bit off-putting if people didn't know or understand you. Those are all things that go in. 10 minutes. I can't give you, nor should I, or could I ever give you all of the things that you should do in terms of image is not everything, but it is the first thing. I simply ask you, as you become a man or a woman of character, personality, and influence, and successful, is don't ignore your image because you have one. Make sure you are projecting the image that you want and gets you the results and hopefully the interactions that are desirable to you, and that you manage it so that you, first of all, are happy with it. When I oftentimes taught young people, college freshmen, how to give their first speech, I said, the first thing to do is dress for your speech, not up, but in what makes you feel good. The clothes you wear for your speech are the clothes that make you feel good. All of those things go into understanding that if you're going to make good friends and make your mark and be truly successful, somewhere in your portfolio of knowledge and understanding and wisdom is very simply the understanding. Image is certainly not everything, but it's something, and it certainly is one of the first things.
And as I said in that presentation, which was actually put together about 5 or 6 years ago, and by the way, there's a video of it if you'd like to see that, just let me know at stanhusted@gmail.com, stanhusted@gmail.com, and I can do that for you and pass it on. But also, if you're trying to cultivate a leadership team, particularly a younger leadership team, the idea of knowing how to manage your image is very, very vital, and we'd be happy to make a presentation for you and your colleagues that would be especially just for you and your team and their particular image issues in your industry. So again, reach out to me at stanhusted@gmail.com, stanhusted@gmail.com. And as I say, one of the best ways to have an image is to always close with a benediction. Always have a word, a good word. So all the best and blessings to you. We'll be in touch next edition of How to Make Good Friends and Make Your Mark in the Marketplace. We'll come your way on Thursday. Bye for now.